Welcome everyone to the 26th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received apologies for today's meeting from Evelyn Tweed, and one of our members is joining us remotely, that's Gillian Mackay, otherwise everyone's here in person. Our first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Is everyone agreed?
Yes.
We're agreed, thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session as part of the committee's pre-budget scrutiny for 2023-24. We have witnesses with us both in person and remotely. In person, we've got Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics from the University of Stirling. Thank you for coming along. Lee Johnson, Senior Manager for Performance Audit and Best Value for Audit Scotland. Good afternoon, Lee. And we have got Professor Raphael Wittenberg, Associate Professorial Research Fellow, the London School of Economic and Political Science. Good afternoon to you, Professor Wittenberg. I'll start things off. I mean, it's a huge area. So, you know, forgive us for the wide-ranging questions. I'm asking you with answers not expected to cover everything. But given that we have got tremendous pressure on the NHS, obviously not just in Scotland, but in the whole of the UK, but obviously we are concerned with the Scottish NHS, given the pressures that are on it from cost of living crisis currently, we've got the fuel costs of running large estates, and all demographic factors about staffing, prescribing costs increasing, all these various pressures that are coming. I guess it's if the current plans for spending on the Scottish NHS look reasonable, notwithstanding the fact that we've got budget reviews happening both in Westminster, and I imagine there's a knock-on effect that will impact on the Scottish Government. But as it stands, can all those pressures, I mean, can that the plans for spending be sustained in the face of all these pressures? I'm going to put that to David Bell.
Okay, thank you for that wide-ranging question. I guess the question is, what can we afford? We have resource constraints. Clearly, we would always have resource constraints. And through the last 10 years, although the amount of spend hasn't increased substantially, health has been protected more than most of the other budgets. And I guess in my paper that I show that the UK as a whole spends around a kind of average for OECD countries in terms of its spend per head, but it jumped, it really jumped much more than most other countries in terms of what happened during the pandemic. Within the UK, the public expenditure statistical analysis shows that Scotland tends to spend more per head than England, not nearly as much as Northern Ireland, or indeed, slightly more than Wales. But in the last few years, that gap has been narrowing between Scotland and England, so that it's now actually quite small. Now, if these figures are right, there's a set of questions that follow from that, have we noticed that waiting times for hospital appointments, for doctor's appointments, have got significantly worse relative to the case in England? I'm not clear that that's true, but it seems that what has happened is that spending in England has grown quite a lot, a little bit faster than in Scotland in recent years. But nevertheless, its outcomes are in some ways, and I'm sure Raphael can talk about social care, are in fact worse than what is the case in the UK, in Scotland rather. So looking forward, you know, health and social care will be the largest budget within the Scottish Government's portfolio. It used to be slightly smaller than local government, but over the last 10 years that has turned round. its projected growth isn't necessarily as big as those in some other of the kind of important, those that spend over a billion. But there's a big changeover coming in, and you can see that from the spend numbers through to 2022-23, in that the National Care Service is going to be established, and there's a big tranche of extra money going to go to inside the health budget. But then how that's split between local government, which is primarily responsible for social care spend at the moment, and health spend is not entirely clear. And if I would add one other thing, which quite a few of the witness or the evidence that the committee has received previously, a lot has been made around preventative spend, and it's not clear that preventative spend has achieved what was hoped of it with the Christie Commission. And it's also then a question of whether the amount of resource that has been allocated to preventative spend has been sufficient to make a difference. You know, more active raising levels of activity, I think is a key objective of the Scottish Government, but whether that is being achieved with the kinds of resources that are being allocated in that direction is a question I think that we need better data on. So I guess I'm saying that there are lots of pressures on the health budget. In demographic terms, we need to be increasing the budget year on year just simply because the population is ageing. But resources are limited, and obviously there are other calls on the Scottish Government's budget. Again, the limitations arise from how quickly the economy is growing and therefore how quickly tax receipts are rising. So that's another consideration that has to be borne in mind when you're looking forward, how much it will be possible to allocate to our NHS bodies, be it the territorial boards or the national boards going forward, depends very much on the health of the economy as well as the division of resources within the total government's portfolio.
And just a reminder to my colleagues online that if you want to come in and add to anything there, then I'll take you. If you just use the chat function and let me know. Otherwise, I'm going to ask a supplementary question to David Bell, and if you just let me know if you want to come in on anything. And it's about that, and I won't go too deep into preventative spend because I have colleagues who want to go into that deeper in the course of this session. But it's, I guess it's about quantifying where the other interventions and other spending portfolios have an impact on health. You know, if you're taking money away from an education budget, yep, towards health, that could have an ill health impact. If you're taking, you know, putting more money into, for example, a net zero, and that has an impact on health as well. And I guess you were saying about data and whatever, but are we almost too fixated on the health budget being about health and not about the general budget having an impact on the nation's health, and how difficult it is to quantify that?
Yeah, I mean, it's extremely difficult to quantify. I was involved in a conversation this morning in Edinburgh University about whether climate change is going to, you know, what effect that is going to have on health and what action might be taken to alleviate that. But before that can happen, we need to have some clear evidence around this. And this, I think, has been part of the problem associated with, I think, to a certain extent, short-term budgets. A lot of the evidence to the committee, I think, criticised the extent to which boards can only look ahead for a year. So that doesn't create a situation in which long-term collection of data, because a lot of the, say you take active interventions in terms of education. I was involved in a discussion previous weekend in Helsinki with some experts on dementia, and they were considering the question as to whether education is a sort of protector against dementia. Now, if you're going to understand that, you've got to have some idea of people, in a sense, people's life histories, because dementia is, before the age of 65, is almost unknown. But then looking back to their education is a long time term before. So you've got to have that willingness to approach data in a systematic way. And I, again, I'm sure Raphael will know also the difficulties there are, particularly in social care, in getting good data. That's a big problem, because it's a very diverse sector, much more so than the NHS in some ways. But there is quite a lot of effort in data, but the question is, does it address the needs as far as these issues that you're raising around the kinds of spend on housing, education and so on, and what effect these really have on people's health?
And it also comes back, I guess, to the issue that's been brought up by quite a lot of people in the written evidence that they gave us around the kind of like the short-term spending, but also the short-term outcomes of things. There are certain things that, like waiting times, you're able to quantify them on a quarterly basis. But the actual health outcomes, that's more difficult to assess.
The trouble is there's a tendency to measure what you can measure.
Yeah.
And that's not necessarily the right thing to measure. And waiting times is possibly an example of that.
Yeah. Can I bring in any of your colleagues who want to maybe answer some of those very wide questions I've put out there to kick us off? Lee, data's been mentioned, and I know that you live and breathe data.
Yes, I guess a few things, convener. So obviously, despite the planned budget increases set out in the resource spending review, we've been very clear that health and social care face an uncertain and challenging financial position over the next 4 years and beyond. And we clearly said in our NHS in Scotland 2021 report this year that the NHS was not financially sustainable even before the pandemic, with boards relying on additional financial support from government and lots of non-recurring savings. And obviously the pandemic has exacerbated the scale of the financial challenge. And NHS boards have been fully funded over the past 2 years to meet their unachieved savings. But in 2022-23, that will stop. And boards are expected to make their planned savings without additional support from Scottish Government. And that will be very challenging given all the pressures that you've outlined in terms of pay costs, inflation, energy costs, as well as ongoing operational costs that have already been an issue. And I think it's important that we know that they are. They will have submitted 3-year financial plans to the Scottish Government. We haven't had a chance to look at those yet, but hopefully that will start to give us a better idea of what the forward-looking financial position looks like for NHS boards. And I think, as you say, in terms of all of the different, in terms of outcomes particularly, and obviously we've also been very clear about the pandemic and the impact that it's had on inequalities, both in terms of health, wealth, education, it's had a profound negative impact on physical and mental health. And it will also have had an impact on the outcomes that are set out in the National Performance Framework. And I think that requires cross-government, cross-public sector, including the third sector, response to try and deal with the inequalities that are so deeply embedded within Scotland, and to try and help improve our outcomes going forward. And that includes, as we've already talked about, a focus on that preventative spend, although we know that that's been very challenging going forward. And as you say, it's also in terms of the outcomes, it is very difficult to know what's being achieved because of the lack of data in certain areas across health and social care, particularly. It is short-term measures that are focused on kind of throughput and output rather than outcomes. And I think there is a need to move towards looking at what outcomes are being achieved by the money that we're spending. A number of our studies, for example, our Children and Young People's Mental Health Service study in 2018, found that we couldn't track the spending, and we couldn't tell what difference any of it was making because the outcomes are just not being measured. And that's repeated across health and social care.
Thank you. And can I bring in Professor Wittenberg before I hand over to my colleagues?
Thank you very much for calling on me. I work mainly on social care, as David Ball indicated. And my work's been my research mainly on England, but I think the general points would apply equally to Scotland. I may just make three points, if that's okay. One is that the demographic or socio-demographic pressures on social care are rather greater than on healthcare. For example, among older people, as you know, the fastest growing numbers among those aged 85 plus, a high proportion of those in care homes, about 70%, have dementia. And the average age of onset of dementia is about 83, 84. So the pressure in respect of social care for older people is very considerable because of its concentration on people aged 80 plus and 85 plus. For the younger age group, there have been and are projected to continue to be large increases in the numbers of people with learning disabilities, including moderate to severe learning disabilities, for which social care may be required. In fact, updating work done by the University of Lancaster on this, we're getting very similar findings of very substantial increases in demand for learning disability services, looking at the numbers expected to turn 18 over the coming decade and beyond potentially. Secondly, that a lot does depend when looking forward to what happens, again, for older people, what happens to disability rates, whether these rates will fall or rise, whether we'll get a compression or expansion of morbidity and disability. We've done quite a bit of work with colleagues in Newcastle on that. I think it's fair to say that the jury is out, the different views, but it makes over time a very considerable difference to what happens to disability rates in later life. And hence, of course, a link with prevention, which has already been raised. I may make a third point, and that is about rise in pay rates in the social care sector. As you know, a high proportion of social care staff, of carers in home care, in residential care homes, are paid at or not much above the national living wage. In our work, in our projections, we take account of the increases that the government has announced up to 2024. And obviously, for a sector with low wage sector, that too makes a big difference for the coming few years. Beyond that, we've assumed that wages in the care sector would rise in line with the wider projections for the economy by the Office for Budget Responsibility. But given the shortages of staff, that may be too low. It may be that wages will have to rise faster in the care sector than in the wider economy in order to recruit and retain efficient staff and sufficient staff with the skills and the aptitude really to work in the care sector. So those are three points I particularly wanted to highlight.
Thank you all, because everything that you've been saying there is a real good springboard for deeper questions from my colleagues that want to pick up on quite a few things that you've mentioned. I'll go to Tess White first of all. Tess.
Thank you. Could I start off with Professor Bell, please? So and I'll just declare I'm a fellow of the Institute of Personnel and Development, so I always look at things from that lens first, before politics. So in terms of two points, the 0.6% increase. So we've got huge pressures on the NHS, and we're talking of such a small increase. Whereas we've got, you know, stats showing 63.5% of patients are being seen within 4 hours. That's the lowest percentage ever recorded. And one of the points that you've highlighted is if you can't plan more than a year or three, or, you know, very short-term planning, then how can you actually deliver any form of workforce plan? And I know part of your background, you looked at labour sort of economics. Part of the issue seems to be, it's not just the money, it's this lack and this inability to workforce plan.
Yeah, so it does seem to me that workforce planning is an essential component of any long-term vision for the NHS, and that must be predicated on making working in the health service, or indeed, as Raphael says, social care, an attractive option. And relatively, the wages of any public sector staff in general, but NHS staff as well, have been falling relative to those in the private sector over the last few years. And as a result of that, not surprisingly, it becomes more difficult to recruit. There's a point that Raphael made which touches on your question, which is also worth bringing up, and that is that although it was perhaps an intention of those who supported Brexit that overall levels of migration to the UK would reduce, that is not in fact the case. Net migration to the UK, a huge proportion of which is going into both health and social care, has pretty much stayed the same. It's just that the location of where people are coming from has changed, so that, for example, whereas we might have had lots of people from Eastern Europe coming pre-Brexit, now it's India, Nigeria, and other countries. Now, so that's just the way things have now panned out. There is a reasonable question as to whether that's sustainable in the long run, to rely to a large extent on migrant labour to be part of your workforce going forward. But it reflects this fact that it's difficult to recruit UK-born, Scottish-born people into health and social care, and a reliance which hasn't really changed in a way, or perhaps if anything increased in terms of migrant workers.
May I ask just one more follow-up,
yep,
Professor,
sure.
Bell? What levers do you think, you can look backwards, but looking forwards, what levers do you think that we can use to pull to change the situation?
Well, I mean, it seems to me that you have to think very carefully about training. Because most of these are, well, all of them effectively are professional jobs. So how do you make training more accessible and more less expensive? That seems to me to be the most obvious route. There's also sort of a recall route. People who have left, because part of the problem, certainly during the pandemic, has been high levels, and understandably, of people who have withdrawn from the NHS, thought has to be given as to how you might find incentives to bring them back in again.
Thank you.
I don't know if any of our colleagues online want to add to any of Tess's questions, but I can come back. So you've got Sandesh Gohani wants to ask a question as well. If you direct it to whoever that is you want to answer it, then I'll bring in Emma Harper.
Thank you. So I wanted to ask a follow-up question to Lee. When we were talking about data and how you're struggling to find information, so sort of a two-part question. Would you like outcomes to be explicitly stated when spending in the NHS is announced? And if not, or on top of, what can we do to improve data so that we can see what the outcomes are? Because let's be honest, outcomes are the most important thing.
I wouldn't like to comment on whether outcomes should be stated when the funding's announced. What we would like to be able to do is to be able to track the funding to see where it's being spent and then know how the outcomes of those different service areas are being looked at, if you like. As I said, I gave the example of our children and adolescent mental health. We couldn't track where the spending was going, and there was very little work into what difference any of the services that were being delivered were making to those children and young people. And I think we've, again, for example, in our integration report in 2018, of course, you've got the health and wellbeing outcomes that were part of that. But they are not reported at a national level. No individual IJBs will talk about those outcomes in their annual performance reports, but it's alongside a lot of indicators that aren't actually telling us a lot about the outcomes. So I think it's important that we can understand, you know, that the public sector is about improving outcomes, and it's very important that we can track the spending and understand what difference it's making.
Forgive me, my question was about, so as you said, you can't track the spending, but what would you like to see happen? How can we track that spending? That was sort of my question, is what difference can we make to make it easier for you?
As I said, there's a range of, as we've commented lots of times, there's just a range of data that is not available. We know very little, for example, about activity and demand in GPs practices, for example. Now, Public Health Scotland are working on that, but how can you plan and scrutinise or make decisions when you don't have solid data to base that on, you know, in community care, in social care, as the other witnesses have talked about? There is very little data. Even in workforce, our workforce data is not as robust and reliable as it could be. And you know, the Scottish Government have published their health and social care workforce strategy and have made lots of commitments about improving the data available to help plan our workforce. But again, they promised that in 2018 in the plan, the workforce plan then, and we've seen very little progress. And the same with the GP data. Again, we've, you know, there's been lots of commitments over the years to improve that situation, but progress has been slow. So I think it's about improving the availability of data so that we can actually begin to look at what is being achieved, what impact things are having, and the difference the money that we're spending is making to people.
Answer. I mean, it's the data is one thing, but then you have to be able to process it, and so making it accessible is. There are lots of ethical problems around that, but if these data are made accessible in an anonymized way, then lots of people can look at it and try to come to the kinds of conclusions about how efficiently the service is running.
Emma, can I bring Emma Harper in?
Thank you, convener. It's on the back of Tess White's question for Professor Bell, and thanks. I will be quick. It's about recruitment and retention, and you know the plans for, I suppose, clinical training, career pathway for health and social care workers. Obviously, you know the Scottish Government have introduced bursaries for nurses and midwifery training and for paramedics now, and also there's free university tuition in Scotland. So obviously, I would think that that would help in recruitment as well. So I'm interested to know if you think anything else should be done or introduced to support further recruitment, but also retention of some of these people that have left the healthcare environment, you know, in addition to the bursaries, and that's been introduced already.
Yeah, I mean, those sorts of measures are obviously the kind of things that you need to get people kicked off into the professions, various professions. Then it seems to me you do need to really understand why people leave. And I guess the pandemic was a very special time where they were under huge pressure. That pressure hasn't completely or even partly alleviated yet because of some of the sort of knock-on effects of the pandemic. But there is, you know, there's a clear need to understand why people leave and whether it's financial incentives on the one hand needed to bring them back, or is it something about work practices on the other, you know, flexibility, childcare potentially, shift patterns, all of these things. I don't have the answer at the moment, but it's a question of being clear why we've seen this leakage from the system.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And before I move on, I'll just check in with Professor Wittenberg. You haven't said that you want to come in the chat function, but social care has been mentioned. I think particular relevance to Emma's question there about people working in social care, and you yourself mentioned issues around staffing there, if you have anything to add.
Thank you very much. I'm happy to do that. I mean, I suppose what the big difference here between, maybe two, between social care and healthcare as far as workforce is concerned. I mean, one's that a high proportion of the social care workforce are not professionals in the same ways of needing degree level qualifications like nursing, or let alone, of course, medicine. But are people who can, in a sense, and a labour force where there's competition between the social care providers, the retail sector, the hospitality sector, so very, very different type of workforce. And secondly, the employers, unlike in healthcare, are mainly not in the public sector. They're mainly private for profit and charitable sector, and therefore one remove, if you like, from the commissioners of the services, the statutory bodies, IJBs and local authorities in England. This makes a very different situation. There is a lack that linked to this of career progression, really, for care workers working in care homes or in the home care sector. Some work we've done using labour force surveys suggests that those leaving the care sector as were carers as opposed to professionals, those leaving may be moving on to the health service or sometimes other parts of local government. And it may be there's a sort of informal career progression, if you like, of people moving from social care into the NHS, perhaps as healthcare assistants and ultimately training. But the one of the big issues, I think, is not just pay, but career progression, career prospects in the social care sector.
Yep, it prompts the question, and sorry to butt in before handing over to my colleagues, the National Care Service, establishment of a National Care Service, that's one of the objectives, is to have that very structured career progression. Do you think that could make a difference in that respect?
I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not aware of the evidence as to how much difference it will make, or whether, I mean, given that, as I understand, the reforms have not happened yet, I suppose one would have to maybe look at other countries, and I'm sorry, I don't know about
messages one would get from other countries. Uh-huh. Thank you. Can I pass on to Paul Kane?
Thank you, convener, and good afternoon to our panel of witnesses. I suppose I'm keen to perhaps build on some of what we heard in that first section around sustainability, financial sustainability. It strikes me from reading some of the work done by Audit Scotland that there's a requirement for innovation in order to get to a sense of financial sustainability. But of course, perhaps what hampers that progress is the challenges of the NHS facing serious financial challenges pre-pandemic and then being exacerbated, I suppose, by the pandemic. So I wonder to what extent do people feel that enough is being done to try and achieve transformation within NHS to then lead to financial sustainability.
Would you like to address that too initially?
Well, so I do have Professor Bell first, and then we can maybe get the Central Audit Scotland.
So this is not my expert topic, but you know, clear, it seems to me that the last two years or so it has really been about just keeping the head above water. So it was pretty difficult to think, and understandably so, to think about innovation over that period of time. It would be good to think that we now have an opportunity to innovate more, and we have to think about where that innovation stems from. To what extent do, say, individual health boards have the freedom to innovate on the one hand, relative to innovations being determined from the centre and sort of rolled out? There's a reasonable question as to what's the most effective way to do that. Should we be encouraging NHS boards to look into changing their practices when they might be worried about being singled out if things go wrong? You know, one cannot expect that every innovation will result in a successful outcome. But maybe we should be prepared to allow for some. I understand it's difficult, but some things may not work, and you've just got to live with that to some extent.
Oh, I wonder if I may convene that, because obviously I think that point is well made about that level of local innovation, but there are national innovations that I suppose we've been waiting on for some time, you know, things like a single patient record and technology and digital. Mm-hmm. Is your sense that a lot of that has to be, I suppose, driven from the centre across all boards in order to try and make some of that difference?
I guess so, and I think you'll get a differential response across boards, because some, they vary so much in size, you know, the capacities to adopt new practices are inevitably partly determined by the size of the boards, because the bigger boards will have that extra leeway, sort of economies of scale argument, to move forward with innovations where the small ones, you know, just don't have that freedom.
I just wonder if Lee might want to comment. Obviously, this my question was partly based around Audit Scotland's analysis, I guess, of that need for innovation to be sustainable, but then the difficulties of standing still.
Yes, absolutely. So again, as we said, I think we did see some innovation through the pandemic, you know, in terms of some of the digital advances, the increase in near me and, you know, non-face-to-face kind of consultations. And I think the recovery plan is also sets out a number of, new ways of delivering services, different patient pathways, for example, the national treatment centres, trying to increase, you know, divert patients away from the acute hospitals to increase inpatient and day case activity. And I think that we have to just not lose some of that progress and innovation that happened during the pandemic and just try and advance it. And of course, the Scottish Government have also set up the Centre for Sustainable Development, which is trying to share some of this new practice and different ways of doing things across the boards, across Scotland. So I think it's just very important that we try and hold on, but there are lots of risks in terms of recovery and redesign going forward. One of them we've already touched on is about workforce. I think it's one of the major risks is that workforce availability. But of course, one of the other things that the Scottish Government are looking at is how we might use staff differently. And of course, that's still to be developed further. But in our NHS in Scotland, we did outline a number of risks around the innovation. And I think it's important that they are thought about and saw through. But as part of our next NHS in Scotland report, we are going to look very much in depth, both at the backlog of patients, but also the deliverability of the recovery plan and the progress that's been made with that and the innovations that are outlined in that. And that's due in February next year.
I think another interesting point that I picked out of Audit Scotland's submission was around leadership and stability in leadership. Audit Scotland have highlighted a lack of stable leadership with a high turnover and short tenure, particularly in terms of directors of finance. So how much do you think the lack of, the right sort of leadership plays in terms of not being able to achieve that long-term sustainability?
I think it's fair to say we've seen it stabilising slightly. The turnover has been less in the last year, but there has been a high turnover of senior leadership. I think our concern is just about that long-term vision of transformation, but also in terms of integration, for example, the ambitions of integrated health and social care services requires collaborative leadership. And if you have high turnover, it's based on relationships and building up trust between different partners to really progress and advance some of the innovations and ideas and new ways of doing things. And of course, if you have that high turnover at that senior leadership level, then that's very difficult to achieve. But I think the other obviously pressing thing right now, our leaders have been under extreme pressure throughout the pandemic, and now they have recovery and redesign to deal with, but also the National Care Service coming into service as well, and having to manage all of that and do it well is very challenging going forward.
Paul. Emma, you wanted to come in with a supplementary question on Paul's question.
Yeah, thanks, convener. Just as I'm picking up from Dr. Bell's paper about the NRAC formula, and there's a review that's been undertaken right now, and there were certain recommendations that were being asked for the way that funding is allocated. So I'm thinking about rural areas, remote and rural, so whether it's Highlands, Islands or the South Scotland area as well. What do you think needs to be changed in the NRAC formula, if anything needs to be changed in NRAC formula?
Yeah, so basically the NRAC formula works to allocate money mainly to the territorial boards, as they're called, which is mainly hospitalisation and GP prescribing. So it's driven primarily by population, then by the age sex structure, and then by various indicators of morbidity and mortality. I don't want to prejudge where that might be going in the future. I think a lot of our discussion today, though, is relevant because, in effect, it's largely about the conditions of demand for health services and how they might be higher in areas where, for example, there are lots of older people. But we maybe need to do some more on how easy or difficult it is to attract workforce to different areas. It is not the case that all of Scotland is equally attractive to healthcare professionals, and some areas we do know have considerable difficulty in recruitment. It's just going back to the overall workforce set of issues. That's me off the cuff suggesting something that might be thought of in relation to this formula going forward. But I'm sure more thought has to go into it.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And I move on to talk about COVID-19 recovery, although we have been skirting round it for the last three quarters of an hour. David Torrance.
Good afternoon to panel members. The budgets in 2021 and 21-22 had large additional sums to health and social care. Is there a need for continued COVID-19 related spending allocation to health boards?
You have to, yeah. So that is a question to which I think there is, as usual, no easy answer. To the extent that, the question is how has COVID changed practices, working practices, and in some senses, they've made things more efficient, as we've heard with the way that GP practices are using online appointments and so on. But to the extent that precautions still have to be taken, then that adds to cost. To the extent that long COVID is still an issue, that also potentially adds to cost. And in relation to what Raphael said earlier, one of the issues that seems to have emerged, particularly in the UK, is that we're actually seeing a lot of pressure on workforce in all kinds of sectors, hospitality being perhaps the most prominent one. But one of the reasons for that is that about 500,000 people have left the workforce, many of them saying that they're disabled. So they were previously working and now saying that they have some kind of problem. Sometimes that it's more common now that mental health is signalled as a possible cause for people having left the workforce. So that will add to the pressures on the NHS. So I'm not giving you a definitive answer, but there are quite a lot of pressures going in different directions, it seems to me. And I guess also the question is, what is your objective in all of this? Is it to return to what might be described as normal levels, which might be 2019, where, as we've already heard, you know, the NHS was struggling to keep its head above water? So that's a sort of incomplete answer, but it touches on some of the issues that are very relevant.
Come in, David, if I can bring it in. Lee.
Thank you, convener. Just to add to that, I think there will be ongoing COVID-19 costs in 2022-23. You know, there's increased infection prevention control measures, amongst many other things. And it is our understanding that NHS boards have been given an individual funding envelope to cover their COVID-19 costs in 2022-23. But there is an expectation that they will begin to manage those down now and ongoing.
Thank you. David.
Around COVID, there was new working practices brought in because of the COVID pandemic. How do we go about redesigning services, and will they bring savings, especially through digital or community care or care in the home? And the reason I'm saying this, but the most important thing is, how do we get the public to buy into them? Because you mentioned GP practices there, and anyone else around this table will know this lack of getting in face-to-face with a GP is probably one of our number complaints.
Sure. I guess the issue is around taking the public with you. I mean, you know, if the public are not happy with the kind of service that they think they're getting, then you know, you can innovate all you like. It's not going to satisfy what they want. And ultimately, you want the best healthcare that you can facilitate, but that can only happen if the public is happy with the way that it's been delivered. Otherwise, then you know, you end up with unmet need. Unmet need is perhaps a way of describing it. People who don't go to the proper diagnostic services and end up having problems that end up difficult to deal with. So I think that the only way is to think about how if you are changing practices, if you are going to use more data, sort of individualised and so on, you've got to use whatever means works best to bring the public along with you in and sort of forming, getting them to form an overall view that this is for the best. This is the best way to proceed.
Professor Wittenbergen.
Sure, I just thought I could, I'd like to mention that we're doing research in the Unit for Research Centre where I work at LSC on a number of the topics that have been discussed in the last few minutes, including, for example, innovation in adult social care, but also on the current topic of COVID and long COVID. Of course, we don't have the results today, but as we have emerging findings, we'd be very delighted to make them available in Scotland as in England. On long COVID, we're looking partly at work with NHS England in respect of registries of data. But we're also just starting a project looking at the impact of long COVID and COVID itself on demand for adult social care. And that reminds me to raise the issue of the unpaid carers, mainly family members, mainly close family, who provide the great majority of long-term care. One of the issues I think we should be looking at in the study we're starting is about the impact of long COVID potentially on unpaid care, both in respect of carers who may no longer be so easily able to care, or people needing care whose condition may be more complex if they have long COVID and other conditions needing care from their family or others. So we are looking at some of the topics that have been under discussion, and hopefully we'll have emerging findings over the next year or two.
Thank you. David, have you got any more questions? One more, and then I'll bring in Carol. Carol
for Audit Scotland. Are management boards or senior managers making the best use of data to recover from the COVID-19, or is there big gaps there that stops them doing this?
I guess all I can comment on is the fact that we have been very explicit about the gaps in the data available. So it leads you to question how decisions are being made and how performance is being scrutinised. As I said before, when we know very little about GP, for example, demand and activity, when we know we don't have a good understanding of what's going on in the community. Some of our workforce data is not as robust and reliable as it could be. And of course, our social care data as well. We've commented on that many times about the lack of social care data. I'm sure locally, boards in different areas are collecting their own information, but I guess what we look at is at a national level of evidently, and it's not available at that national level. So yes, I would question sometimes whether there is sufficient data to be making planning and making good decisions.
Thank you. Carol.
Thank you, convener. I wonder if I could just ask a quick question to Lee Johnson. Recently, it's been mentioned to me that one of our responses to COVID in the hospitals was to increase bed capacity, understandably, and that has continued. And what some of the boards are concerned about is that the staffing was never brought up. We have staffing issues in terms of recruitment, but also that the full-time equivalent posts are just not, are not there. Possibly running around about 70% of staffing allocation of funding is what was mentioned to me. Is that something that you have picked up on across the board?
We've not looked at this in any detail. I guess the only thing I would comment on is what we do. Obviously, we do know that there's been huge staff absences, but also I think a significant increase in the use of agency and locum staff. I guess that doesn't really answer your question, but it just shows the pressure that services are under to have sufficient staff in place to meet the needs of their different services. as I've said, in terms of the huge increase in agency costs and locum costs.
Just very quickly, if I wanted to look at, you know, like sort of, you know, bed capacity before and after, who would be the best place to look at that information and what the staffing levels would be around that?
I think it would be a mixture in terms of bed capacity would be someone like Public Health Scotland, and then staffing it would be NHS Education Scotland, who are now responsible for staffing data. And that's where you'd be able to access that.
That's helpful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And Emma, you wanted to pick up on something that Lee Johnson said.
Yes, thank you, convener. I'm sorry to just keep coming in, but it's just Lee mentioned that there was data missing from like general practice or other information. Why is that? And is there a plan to get that data? And is that something that's in process, as Audit Scotland have highlighted that data is missing?
We do know that Public Health Scotland are working on trying to improve the situation. I think they're due to publish some data kind of early to springtime next year. It will be a fairly high level data. We've, I think, told the committee before, you know, there has been other areas that they've been working on in terms of the Spire system within GP practices. It's been patchy in terms of whether practices adopt that or not. So again, the data is going to be patchy. But I think, as Professor Bell also mentioned, there are also issues, I think, around data protection and the data ethics of some of that data. And I think you can get, you can make applications to get some of that data about kind of different specialities or condition specific data, but you have to go through a long process. I think our point is that there's not nationally available data to really give us a good insight into activity and demand within GP practices. But as I said, Public Health Scotland, as far as we are aware, are working on that and are due to publish data early to mid next year.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Move on to health and social care pay. Questions from Stephanie Callaghan initially.
Thank you, convener. And thanks for coming along today, everyone. Talking about pay, we've touched on it quite a lot today already, and we have had, since the end of 2019, there's been a significant increase in employment in NHS Scotland. We're looking at 14,000. And that's not something we're expecting to drop off again to pre-pandemic levels, and quite rightly so. So really, we have two really big demands right across health and social care. Number one, increase in pay, and especially with high inflation and the expectation that that will rise further. And number two, that demand for additional staff. So I'm wondering, how can these two be balanced? And I'll ask that to Professor Bill first of all.
If you want to increase the complement as far as the different professions within the NHS is concerned, then you've got to consider the set of issues that attract people to work in the NHS. Now, that will include, of course, pay. It also includes conditions. Conditions is a wide set of topics. But clearly, you want people to be comfortable within that profession. But pay matters, relative to what people's alternative is. It's most obvious in social care, as Raphael has said, because the alternative is often retail or hospitality or whatever, because the training requirements are not so high as in the professions. In the NHS professions, but nevertheless, you can get people withdrawing, looking for other careers. So, if there is a desire to increase the overall complement, and you've got to establish there is a need to do so, I guess, if you are being successful with your prevention strategies, then you might well not need to think about such a large increase. But if you want to maintain that higher establishment, then you can't ignore pay. And of course, it's always about the next best alternative. It looks to me like real pay for most people is going to be falling this year, in the sense that the rate of inflation is going to exceed the increase that's feasible in terms of nominal salaries. It's just the least worst of those options that people may well want to go for. So I guess if there's increasing disenchantment with the real levels of pay that people are getting, then that means almost redoubling the effort to make sure that conditions are suitable, and that even given the cost of living fall, that working in the NHS is still sufficiently attractive to keep people within it.
Mr. Wittenberg.
There's been some research on, I think, the link between nurses' pay and the supply of nurses by the Institute for Fiscal Studies. I'm sorry, I don't have the findings in front of me, but I'm very happy to send the clerks a note of the reference for it, if that would be helpful.
Thank you. Stephanie.
Yeah, that would be incredibly helpful to have that through there. And you've kind of picked up on another point, Professor Bale, as well, around prevention strategies and the difference that could make. So these kind of preventative care and strategies there as well, are they something that you would expect to make quite an impact then going forward? Are there concerns as well around service delivery, if pay is taking up quite a chunk, on how service delivery might actually be affected by that if there's less funding there?
So, it's a trade-off. It's always a trade-off here. And why it seems to me that preventative strategies have suffered relatively is that it's so difficult to establish how effective they are. So I was in Finland 3 days ago and learned that Finnish schools all close for a number of days each year, and all of the children go out to ski. We have the Daily Mile in Scotland to get activity levels up. The Minister for Public Health, Marie Todd, is very keen on increasing activity levels. So increased activity is one part of it. Reduced smoking, reduced alcohol are also both parts of it. It's very difficult to show what the difference is, because the difference is going to come years later. What we do know is, that Scotland's life expectancy is low compared with European countries. Its healthy life expectancy is low relative to other European countries. So what we're spending on the NHS isn't making that difference. We're spending about the same, but in those overall terms, the outcomes are certainly not that good. But it's the difficulty again of short-term budgeting, putting in place these long-term strategies. I was speaking to someone this morning, and I'm very glad that the Daily Mile, which was a Scottish invention, seems to be pretty much established. But selling those at the sharp end when there are real problems about healthcare delivery systems through the NHS or through the social care system is extremely difficult.
It'd be good as well if Professor Weinberg is able to comment too.
I'm not sure I quite caught the question. Lee, so is it about prevention, preventive measures?
Yep, so the impact of preventative measures and having a bit of protection, if you like, but also as well, I had asked about service delivery too, you know, if there are increasing demands for staff pay and therefore less money to be spent in actual service delivery, the kind of concerns around that and how it might tackle them. Thanks.
Yeah, on prevention, I mean, in the field of social care, in the sense of preventing the onset of disability or the worsening disability, the evidence, unfortunately, rather limited. And we did some work with colleagues in other European countries. And it's only really in very particular areas, like, say, falls prevention, that there is firm evidence. And I think one of the challenges is lack of evidence in terms of preventing disability in later life. And as David Ballas indicated, it would not be easy to generate that evidence because of the long time lags between intervention and the desired outcome. One area we have worked with colleagues and we're trying to do more work on is prevention of dementia. And in that field, I think there's even a shortage of perhaps information really among the public that Alzheimer's disease, Alzheimer's dementia, that it is in parts preventable, at least a third of it is preventable through various reduction in various risk factors, partly the ones have already been mentioned relating to smoking, physical activity, also to controlling blood pressure, for example, in middle age, which we've shown is cost effective, even if one looks only at the dementia outcome. And others may be less well known, like the use of hearing aids, that there's now evidence that hearing loss, if it's not corrected using hearing aids, is a risk factor for dementia. So there may be some new fields where there could be interventions that would be helpful, but the evidence is, I think, part, as David Ballas indicated, part of the challenge there.
Thank you. Thank you, Stephanie. Moving on to discussing the National Care Service, which, of course, we are about to scrutinise in stage one in coming months. I'll hand over to Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. Just on that last comment, I think I might email you outside because I've not heard that before
about hearing aids. Loss. Yeah.
But no, definitely something I might do. But just on the National Care Service, if we move on to the theme I've got, I was looking through the call for evidence and I saw a lot of respondents when it came to the financial memorandum that was presented just before the summer recess. I'll give you an example. West Lothian Integration Joint Board said there is so little detail provided in the financial memorandum as to the basis of the cost, it is impossible to say if the costs included are reasonable and accurate. So I suppose my question to David Bell is, do you share those concerns?
I think to a certain extent, I do. I haven't been closely involved. I did speak to Derek Feely in the course of his inquiry, but I haven't been closely concerned with the sort of implementation. And I've got to say that I'm not clear exactly how the additional money is going to be allocated. You know, adding extra money to the NHS is reasonably straightforward. Adding it to the care service, as Raphael has already said, it's such a complex sector between voluntary private providers, unpaid carers. You know, there are a host of actors in this particular area. So how you provide additional resource and what that means at the national level does seem to me to be a big challenge. Raphael mentioned the possibility of having a more structured a better career structure for carers, and I think, you know, if that was part of the new care service, then that would be a plus. But there are a lot of unknowns, it seems to me, around how it might affect local delivery. So I'm sort of reserving judgment at the moment to see how it further develops.
Thank you. wondering if Lee might have a thought on that as well.
Lee?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Again, obviously, we've submitted a response to the consultation around the bill. And I think, given the details of the arrangements have yet to be finalised and determined, the scale of the costs involved in the financial memorandum or estimates, I think, with a lot of caveats. So I think our take is that the affordability of the vision set out is not certain, given that the actual scale of the costs are not yet clear, I think would be our take on that.
Thank you. So local authorities and other stakeholders are also very concerned about the administrative and structural costs of establishing the National Care Service. And do you share their concerns that a high administrative cost will lead to less financial resource for service delivery?
So the clearly there will have to be some sort of administrative overhead to the associated with the National Care Service. So we've seen similar things in relation, for example, to Social Security Scotland. I've got to say that I'm unclear at the moment as to what that might mean and what the trade-off there might be between additional efficiency savings at the local level compared with the administrative costs at the national level. I really don't feel that I can comment on that, because it's not clear how these, first of all, what the size of the administrative overhead is going to be, and then how efficiencies might be gained at the local level, given, as you know, I've said already, it is a much more diverse sector than is obviously than the National Health Service.
Thank you. And just one final question. So if you're saying that you're unclear about it, what can we do to make that data available, to make it clearer as to what's happening?
So I mean, part of it is around where local authorities now are going to stand in the future in relation to the provision of care services, and how the other there is clearly a potential gain through improved interaction, fewer delayed discharges, improved interaction with the health service, I should say, and fewer delayed discharges. We seem to be getting to a good place as far as delayed discharges were concerned, around 2018 or thereabouts. But you know, with the difficulties that the pandemic caused in the care home service, successes have to some extent been wiped out. So I think all that I'm doing is conveying uncertainty here, it will be important for the committee to understand more clearly than I think is possible at the moment how exactly the implementation will run through, what the administrative costs are, how it will affect local authorities and the interaction between local authorities and the NHS, and also the interaction with all of the separate providers around there, and whether, you know, we largely adopt the same charging structure as is run in England, with slight variations, but not massive variations, around when you become self-funding, for example, in social care. And will there be changes around those sort of asset-based tests as to whether people become self-funding or not?
Thank you. We'll move on to talking about the NHS estate and the sustainability of it. Emma Harper, you're leading on this.
Yep, thanks, convener. So I've been doing a bit of reading since we got our papers last week about the NHS estate and sustainability, and how can the NHS become achieve net zero by 2040. And so I'm interested in what the panel might think about, I guess, the issue of 20 million miles per annum has been saved by the implementation of Near Me during the pandemic. So that shows that mileage reduction can be achieved. And I thought that was a hefty figure, which when calculated into CO2 emissions, it's in the billions of milligrams of CO2 saved. And then there was another issue about remote clinics or virtual clinics and using telemedicine so that like blood pressures can be obtained remotely and then analysed by a GP to see the results without actually seeing a patient. So I'm interested in what the panel think about how do we, I suppose, marry up the technologies, how do we get the biggest bang for our buck in saving on emissions in our NHS estate? I suppose we'll go to Professor Bell first, since you're in front of me.
So this is not my specialist subject. Clearly, all of the, there have been a lot of innovations that have been moving in the right direction. Use of drones as well is another area that, you know, for delivering medicines is another one that has been explored. I guess the issue is that a lot of the estate is not that efficient in terms of its annual usage of CO2, the actual estate, and it's not just, well, transport is very important, but it's the physical buildings, and then the question around what is the investment, levels of investment needed to convert these to being more sustainable. And for some, that will be a big challenge, it seems to me, around hospitals, for example. Progress can only be made if the investments are made, and also the learning is shared across different parts of the NHS, and the willingness to do that is very important, it seems to me.
And would either of our remote colleagues like to come in this? Lee, I could see you nodding along as David Bell was speaking. Would you like to come in?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Professor Bell, but we, again, not an area that we've done a huge amount of work in. We did identify the net zero requirements as adding a challenge to the NHS recovery process, and the fact that it will need additional investment in the already pressured budget. But I guess the one thing that we agree is that it is vital that NHS make the most of the opportunities arising during the pandemic to reduce carbon emissions, for example, from the things that Professor Bell's talked about and Near Me. You know, it's not just about the reduced travel, but obviously during that was reduced PPE, things like that, that are all contribute towards it. Climate change is in our work programme going forward. We will do more work in this area, but it's just not an area that we've done an extensive or in-depth look in terms of the NHS at this point.
Thank you. I guess back to Lee, I'm just thinking also, you know, we do still need to make journeys as part of the NHS travel. So I'm thinking about the Scottish Government have a switched on fleets fund, it's 20 million quid, and NHS Lothian are using it, and Aberdeenshire Council have added 20 new zero emission vehicles using this Scottish Government funding. And I'm thinking, so you can measure these journeys, we know the mileage if NHS employees are making a travel distance, but also I'm thinking about dialysis patients, very predictable journeys if they're using taxi vehicles, which many do. So you know where the start point is, you know the end point, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, same patients, same appointments every week. So that would be something that would be very measurable if Audit Scotland are looking for data in how we can measure emissions reductions by replacing the vehicles that are diesel-driven with electric vehicles. Is that something that we should be looking at? Is that something where we can get a big win if we really rapidly adopt electric vehicles for the likes of those patient journeys that we can measure and demonstrate emissions reduction?
As I said, I mean, I just haven't done enough work in this area to really know whether that is, but it's something that I can flag to our climate change team. We do have a team working on this at Audit Scotland who will be looking at the different ways that we can look at how progress is being made in the public sector to meet some of these commitments and targets that have been set going forward. So I will pass that on to that team.
Okay, thanks. So thanks. Thank you. And I will halt there because...
Giving out homework. can I move on to discussing in more detail preventative spend? I've got some questions from Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thanks, convener, and good afternoon to the panel. In the panel's opinion, given the increased pressure from COVID-19 on waiting times and other areas within the NHS, is it realistic to move towards greater preventative spend in the medium term?
And who would you like to address that to, first of all, Gillian?
Could I maybe go to Lee first?
Thank you.
Please.
Thank you. I think, again, the focus is on recovery, and obviously there is a backlog, and that's very important to people, to our communities out there. But I guess one of the other things that we identified in our NHS in Scotland report that was published in February, that one of the risks with the recovery is that we lose sight of prevention and early intervention. It's so key to reducing our inequalities as well. Equitable access to services. But again, as we've said many times, we know that is not an easy task. It's been very difficult to achieve anywhere else. We've found that moving resources towards prevention, early intervention, often requires a significant change in how services are delivered. It may involve reducing budgets in some areas and increasing others and targeting resources to specific groups of people. We do know that certain areas, in terms of our community planning partnerships and integration authorities, have started to explore some kind of small scale preventative projects, but a significant scaling up of that activity is needed. But that will require, I think, difficult local choices in terms of what you prioritise, but also a stronger shared strategic planning across an area for prevention, because I think, as we've already discussed earlier, I don't think it's just about health. Health can't do it on its own. It has to be across government, across public sector, across third sector initiative, if you like, to try and implement that.
Gillian?
I'll probably go back to Lee again for this question. Is there an argument that in the first instance, and we've touched on this earlier, that preventative measures should be taken in areas with higher excess mortality or in areas where the number of healthy years of a person's life is expected to be lower?
I don't know if I have a particular view on that. I guess I would argue that it's important across the board, that I think that it has to be thought about in all areas, if you like. But as I've said, there are specific groups of people that perhaps need resources targeted towards them in that early intervention prevention space. I think you mentioned it in the call for evidence. That the care and wellbeing portfolio that the Scottish Government are implementing, it's an early stage of development, but it does, one of its prongs is around preventative and proactive care. And within that, I guess the government are committed to designing a kind of new coherent and sustainable system focused on reducing inequality, prioritising prevention and early intervention, and improving health and wellbeing outcomes. And its objectives as part of that include a decision-making framework that prioritises prevention and early intervention, which I guess we would say is promising, but we need more detail. We haven't got enough detail. That's still in the development and in the early stages. It does sound promising, but we really need to see more detail around that. So it'll be interesting to see how that develops and whether what possibilities it brings, I guess.
Gillian, David Bell would like to add to that.
Hi. So I'm actually on the advisory board for an investigation into health inequalities in Scotland that the Health Foundation are currently carrying out, and it may be of interest to the committee to hear that report once it's available, which should be towards the end of the year.
Coming after our report next week.
Oh, right.
So, okay. we're well aware of the Health Foundation's right. work on this okay. as well.
So, I mean, I guess I would say that there is a case for targeting preventative measures those areas that have the lowest healthy life expectancy. I know that some areas are starting to invest to think about things like social prescribing. I know that bodies like the RNA are buying up golf courses in deprived parts of Glasgow and trying to make that particular activity a more accessible activity for people from more deprived backgrounds. And, you know, if sport in general, I guess the sport that has done most is probably football. In terms of providing facilities, encouraging people in deprived areas to get involved. And that, at the end of the day, is the sort of thing which helps increase activity levels. And we're pretty clear that increased activity is a thing which leads to better health outcomes in the long run. But again, it's in the long run, and again, we've got to understand how big that effect is.
Thank you. Gillian, do you have any more questions?
Nope, that's me, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A final line of questioning on this. Sorry, Stephanie, do you want to come in?
Yes, please, if I
of course
could.
You can.
Thank you. For Professor Bale, I'm wondering as well, you know, the National Care Services is very much, you know, we're talking about focusing on what it is that actually matters to individuals. So it's about supporting people to achieve the outcomes that they want to achieve. And my thinking is, you know, very, very much that's about their health and wellbeing. You know, they feel better. It's likely to improve their wellbeing, which can have a huge impact on health as well. So that really seems to be quite at the heart of the National Care Service. So I'm wondering, how much do you feel that the preventative impact of that, for example, kind of falls into the bigger picture, if you like. I don't know that I've explained that particularly well.
A number of different things jumped into my mind there. One, when you said about, you know, people's choices, one of the things that I should have said that I'm not really clear about is how self-directed support will fit into the new National Care Service. And how indeed that links up with the payments that are being made through a Social Security Scotland in relation to disability, because all these things are linked together. So achieving sort of outcomes that relate to people's personal wishes in relation to health and well-being, there's a big question about the extent to which these are determined by people's own choices rather than what professionals think is good for them. And I'm not taking a view here about that, but that's something that has to be part of the consideration of the design of the National Care Service, it seems to me, and also to make sure there's not sort of double counting in terms of the support that is being given to people. So self-directed support took off pretty slowly, but is now, you know, reasonably well embedded across quite a lot of local authorities. And what role that will play, I've got to say, I'm not clear about.
Sorry, just a short follow-up question to that. I'm just wondering as well then, so, you know, you're talking about sometimes it being the professionals quite often as well that are leading things in a certain direction. And I'm wondering if there's a place perhaps for something like an individual action plan that people have that they share with different health, different social care providers, etc., that actually really keeps centering things back to their own priorities, because it could be quite easy when they're having those conversations, you know, they're getting very limited options or whatever. Is that something that could really help, or does that kind of fly in the face of things being based on data and evidence, etc.? Or
not really. I mean, with healthcare interventions, there usually isn't a choice. You know, if you've got appendicitis, you need an appendectomy. But if you need social care, then the options are much wider about how that could best be achieved. And it makes sense that the individual receiving the care or their representative, their guardian, helps make those decisions. And it seems to me to be important that the National Care Service takes account of that. I'm sure that is part of the thinking, but exactly how it's done will be important for the overall level of satisfaction that there is with that development.
Professor Wittenberg.
Thank you. I think I made 2 points. On the previous discussion, I took part on an evaluation of the Well London programme, which was about prevention in deprived areas of East London. The outcomes were rather mixed, but if that was of interest to the committee, again, I could send the links to that. On the current topic of cash for care, my understanding of such evidence as there is that there's a big difference between different groups of service users. It's much more attractive for, say, younger disabled people who may welcome the opportunity either to employ their own carer or to be in control of the care that they receive. For older people, it's been rather less acceptable. Indeed, anecdotally, I can remember speaking to a group of older service users who said they just saw it as a mechanism for the statutory authorities to transfer the burden of organisation for the service user away from the authority. But I think that it does depend on the user group, but it may also be that, for example, for older people, that support services in the actual use of the cash for care, the direct payments, may therefore be very important from such evidence as I'm aware of.
Thank you. Our final line of questioning is on health and social care outcomes. Of course, this is a thread that's been going through everything, but Tess, you have some questions on this.
I do. Thank you, Convener. And I think this is one for the panel, but if I can start off with Professor Bell. So it's a question around sort of the conflicting priorities and balancing outcomes. So you've got increased labour costs, increased drug costs, in terms of capital costs, but also an immediate need to reduce waiting times and improve treatment times. So how do you balance those immediate needs and those immediate outcomes with the longer term outcomes?
A very difficult question. Because effectively rationing short-term supply of healthcare is extremely unpopular. Saying that we have to look to the long term is extremely unpopular. What it does do is it perhaps drives some people to the private sector. And I think that's increasingly the case at the moment that's happening. Ultimately, I suppose the government should be driven by what works or what's the best outcome among the conflicting alternatives. But it's very difficult for governments to avoid responding to short-term requests, it seems to me. So unless you're prepared to countenance some different, you know, different funding mechanism, it seems to me that the probability is that it will be the short-term measures which win out, and we push further and further into the future the kind of long-term strategies that we spent a lot of time this afternoon talking about.
Thank you.
Would you like to go round the panel?
Yes, please.
For their views? If I go to Professor Wittenberg first, then.
I mean, I think this, in the end, much of this is about really is a policy decision rather than one that's readily amenable to analysis. I mean, in pure theory, one could probably imagine analysis which looked at the gain in life years or quality-adjusted life years from short-term measures and from long-term measures and tried to compare them. But I think, first of all, one's up against real difficulties about the evidence. Secondly, I think one can't really escape the issue about how to discount the future as against the present. As you know, Treasury guidance is that future costs and benefits should be discounted, regarded as less valuable than short-term ones. But in the end, I think there's an element of judgment in that. I mean, my feeling is that it's, I think, to give a purely sort of health economics analytical answer, I think, would be probably not realistic. And in the end, a lot of it comes down really to policy judgment.
Thank you. We'll go to Lee Johnson.
I don't think I have much to add. I think, as we've already talked about, you know, the health and social care financial position is very challenging going forward. And I think across Scottish Government, not just in health and social care, there will be some difficult decisions to be made going forward. But obviously that is for government to decide and not something that we would comment on where those decisions should be made.
Thank you. Tess?
Thank you. In terms of just one a comment, and I don't know if I've read correctly or heard correctly, it's almost as though the balance between the decision to put the wheels on the bus because the bus is not moving, or decide strategically where that bus is going. Is that correct?
There certainly is a bit of that. You know, it's got to be, and it is a political choice.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tess. Final question to Emma, unless I have other people want to come in the last couple of minutes. But Emma, it's over to you.
Okay, thanks very much. It's kind of going around like we're talking about preventative spend, we're talking about better outcomes, we're talking about better health overall. And I'm thinking of one example of keeping people out of hospital from asthma attack or COPD exacerbation. Overnight stay in hospital is minimum £1,100. But if somebody was having their annual asthma plan reviewed, and they're taking their inhalers appropriately, whether it's their COPD or whether it's asthma, that helps keep people out of hospital. So, but in order to support the practice nurse or the specialist in airway management or respiratory, that means that has to be done in primary care. But that means then, do we take money away from secondary care and give it to primary care, or do we have to figure out, do we get an extra pot of money from somewhere? And then how do we have a wee borrowing pot? Oh, no, we don't, because we can't borrow money in Scotland. So what's the best way to, you know, take a pot of money and divvy it up in the best way possible?
Well, I mean, you could, as Raphael said, you could do the sort of calculation, and perhaps that kind of calculation would be more appropriate in this context, because not really one that has big political overtones, but it's one which it's possible to figure out which is going to give you the most bang for your buck in terms of, the technical term is quality adjusted life years. But the issue then is the division of resource between hospitals on the one hand and primary care on the other. And there is a question about how effectively primary care's case is being made for it when the division comes up in budgetary terms, and if programs like that are sufficient, are deemed to be sufficiently important to warrant that kind of intervention. But again, we're sort of going back to data and the presentation of evidence as to how our overall budget should be allocated as between, on the one hand, hospitals in this case and primary care on the other.
Thank you. I want to thank three panellists for giving us so much food for thought as we approach our budget scrutiny, and for all their very helpful pointers, particularly as we approach National Care Service scrutiny as well. That's all we've got time for in this particular panel, so I thank you to you all. Members, we have got one final item on our agenda, and that is consideration of a negative instrument. And that instrument is the General Pharmaceutical Council Amendment Rules Order of Council 2022. Excuse me. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considers this instrument at its meeting on the 6th of September, and they made no recommendations. And the purpose of the instrument is to allow the Appeals and Fitness to Practice Committees of the General Pharmaceutical Council to hold meetings or hearings using audio or video conferencing facilities on a permanent basis. In addition, in-person meetings and hearings will also continue to be available, and no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments in relation to the instrument? Don't? Nobody does, thank you. I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Any member disagree with that? Thank you, colleagues. So we are agreed. Our next meeting, the committee will take evidence on winter planning for the NHS and social care. But that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.